Hi everyone, welcome back to this channel. In this video, I'm going to take you through the process of reproducing a paper published in Science by Karthaus et al. In 2020. The paper reveals a regenerative potential of prostate luminal style that is an important implication for prostate cancer research. There are several reasons why I want to choose the paper. First, it published in 2020, which there is no default single-cell RNAseq analysis that is available by that time. So its methods state very clearly about each of the bioinformatic steps and explain them in a very detailed way. And secondly, the paper provided the data set that is after the pre-processing by cell ranges, so in the normal laptop, it's very easy to process the data set in R. So in this video, I'm going to walk you through the R analysis to see how they do it step by step. But before that, I want to summarize a bit what is the difference of how their paper work versus the standard way that we do it in Shrek package nowadays. I have found two main differences in this paper. The first one is that they use the non-negative metric factorization NMF and a graph clustering based approach. This NMF way is similar to the PGA principal component analysis that we've been using. It's a way to do the dimensional reduction. Unlike PGA, which assumes a linear relationship between the features, NMF assume a non-negative linear relationship between the features, so it can identify the pattern that might not be able to detect it using the PGA way. This can be especially useful for single-cell RNAseq analysis, where gene expression can be highly variable and non-linear. Another interesting aspect of this paper is that they use XGBoost model to train and assign the cell type for each of the cell as a way of the cell type annotation. This is different from the Shrek integration method, where we try to integrate all the time points into the same data set, and then we try to assign the cell type to the cluster in the integrated data set. Instead, in the paper, the author first identified the cell type in the original time point using NMF and graph clustering approach just now. And how they assign is that they use the manually selected the toast round established cell type marker to identify the cell type for each of the cluster. They then train the XGBoost classifier to predict the cell type for the cells from other time points based on their gene expression profile. So XGBoost model is a machine learning algorithm that can identify the complex pattern that can be missed by single linear models. This can be especially useful for the time series data set that the cell type might undergoing transcriptional changes over time. And secondly, XGBoost can be more robustly to handle missing data set and also the noisy features that not able to than some integration method. And thirdly, the classifier make it more convenient for us to assign the cell type to a new set of the data by not integrating them together. Next, I'm going to walk you through the R script to see how they analyze step by step. And if you are interested, you also can download my script from my GitHub. So we can download the data set using this GBoost number, GSD146811. They have that three files here. I just want to focus on this raw count because it's where we can do whatever downstream analysis onward in R. The other one that's similar to raw count is that this log2tp10k, and this is the after normalized from the raw count. I still prefer to use the raw count from the beginning. And then they also provided the TSV file, which is their metadata that telling us their assigned cell type for each of the cell ID. So this is very important when we want to validate our analysis to see whether it is similar with what they have analyzed. Okay, so I have put it in the R markdown. And firstly, we can see that how the data set look like. The data set actually is just like from, so I use the raw count data and also their metadata in the TSV. this data set, they have several batch and time point. The FP and non-FP one, we don't really want it because it's another experiment in their paper to show that their sorting rate is not really optimal for the separating epithelial cell from using the sorting marker. So that's why the rest of the experiment, they don't really do any sorting marker. They just try to extract the single cell RNAseq data set based on what they thought the prostate, which is concentrated at the AP loop. The one that we want to focus is that they have many time points, which come from T00, time 0, and until castration. Go to the regenerated period. They have two levels of prediction. The first one is the so-called high-level prediction, which they roughly to group the cell into three main cell types, which is the epithelial, stroma, and immune cell. So this is what they have stored in their high-level prep. And then for each of the high-level cell type, they will subset each of them, the three subsets, and do the downstream in a parallel way. So which means for the epithelial cluster, they have further divide them into luminal cell, basal. Also for immune, they will assign to B cell, T cell, and for stroma, they will assign it to fibroblast or mesenchymal. So this is how they do in a separate way. Okay, so next I will try to do the clustering as what they stated is like for NMF and graph-based approach. So firstly we have to subset the that's only the intact, the time 00 chamber, which is the intact chamber, only two data set. And then I try to do the filtering based on what they stated. Firstly, I will try to follow how they filter the cells, which is like fewer than 500 genes, fewer than 5,000 bits, and fewer than 100 UMI. So I will check the criteria in this way, like N featured R more than 500, N count RNA more than 1,000, and the mitochondrial ratio is more than 15%. Okay, so next, that is the normalized data. I found that is similar to what the Shurek stated. The state here, to account for differences in sequencing depth across cells, UMI counts were normalized by the total number of UMIs per cell and converted to transcript per 1,000. So this is exactly how the default of the normalized data work. So we can see here, it's also similar. They try to do it in the skill factor 10,000 and 5 variable gene is similar to what they, is similar to the Shurek package also. They also choose a 2,000 gene based on an elbow-based criterion and apply to the median of over difference statistic based on 200 sample of 75% of cells. So I found it is very similar to the Shurek package 5 variable feature. So I will just watch it. And then they also try to do the quantile normalization to the gene expression. And also they use NMF later on to account for specifically for batch differences. And they also state the NMF with the parameter K equal to 21. I will just follow. And then they also stated all the cell type marker that will be used to identify the cell type for each of the cluster. Okay, so when they do it, I will just do follow the normalized data, 5 variable feature. And when they come to the skill data, we have to be careful that for NMF, because there is non-linear, so we don't want to do the standard, so we set it as false. And for the NMF approach, I use the package called RLegal. RLegal have the function called runOptimalALZ, which we can use the NMF way to do the dimensional reduction instead of the run PCA. Right. The next is the run quantile norm, which they stated also in the paper that they want to run the quantile normalization on the data set. And next will be the same for the 5 neighbors and 5 clusters, but we can state it clearly that the reduction name is called INMF law. And the rest, the run new map is how they say it is as a way to do it in a graph-based clustering. And so after run all this day, you can see that this is how the things look like. Okay, yeah, so this is the how the your map plot look like with the resolution of 0.5. I also try to reproduce the gene feature plot. Yeah, these three are the basal marker and these three are the luminal marker. And we can see that it's very similar to what they say in the in their data set, in their feature. Yeah, so this is the basal and luminal marker. Even though the position is very reasonable that they're different, because for the UMAP is they can't really always reproduce to the same location, but the pattern is very similar. And then this one, AppCam is to state the whole epithelial cluster, and immune is referring to the PTPRC where they express. So those group that not expressed in both AppCam and PTPRC are called as stroma. Okay, and then these three are the markers for the seminal vesicle, either it's the luminal or basal. Then they have found this one is the it means maybe they have some contamination of the seminal vesicle luminal. Okay, so next we can come to classify the high level cell type based on just the AppCam and PTPRC. So I use the average expression way to try to identify them. So from here, we can try to read the gene count number. This is the normalized count, and then we can assign those like whether it's expressed or not, we assign them accordingly. And thus, we can see that this is how is the plot look like. Okay, and I want to show you that the left hand side is what I define based on the average expression that I manually assign. So we can see that epithelial, stroma, and immune, and high level threat is what they defined previously and stored in their metadata. And we can see that my prediction is all similar, and that also can tell that my previously the NMF and graph-based approach are really similar to what they have done before. Okay, so next we try to subset to epithelial cell only, in a way to train the XGBoost model. So firstly, I try to subset them, and from here we can try to identify the epithelial subtype based on the cell type marker that they given in the supplementary data. And then also similarly, I use the average expression function to try to look for the expression in each of the cluster and assign them accordingly. Now they have one basal and three luminal group. So after assign the basal and luminal cell type, we can go to the XGBoost training for this epithelial intact that is include luminal and basal. So we need the library called XGBoost and tiny models. And this step actually, I want to acknowledge the tutorial that provided by Dr. Tang that have used this way to find the marker gene in single cell RNAseq. So I mainly try to adopt his script for the following analysis. Okay, so we need the library XGBoost and also library tidy model, and then we can train using the basal and luminal subtype and seminal vesicle luminal. So from here, we try to get the data that have all the the data is looked this way. We have the cell ID and also the expression of the related gene marker. Here I try to put it only include those like in the epithelial cell type marker that provided by the paper. But of course, at the beginning also, we can try to use as many genes as possible, because at the end, this model training would give us a list of the genes that very important for the training, and we can use those in only. So we can split them into two, which is like the training set and also the data set. And then we also can try to do like how many fold of the cross validation. They have other hyperparameter that work to fine tune, and from there they also a way to try to get the best penalty, which is the best result here, like this. So now we know that this is the parameter that work to use it for the downstream, and after that we can try to fit the model using the pre-selected parameter. Okay, so this is how I predicted, and I got it the tool and the prediction here, and we can see that it's not 100% accurate, but also I don't really have a time and effort to try to fine tune it. But we can always fine tune by adjusting the range of the parameter and also how you fit in the relevant feature. Next, you also can do the same to for the immune subject of the intact. You try to subject it and then run the NMF and graph-based clustering method, manually assign the cell type and then train the model for the immune cell type only. So same goes for the trauma, and next we can try to use it for other time point of the data set. So here I try to use just the intact versus castrate in day 28 for a convenience. Then we can try to run the same set of the analysis, try to get the normalized scale and dimensional reduction and also clustering. And here I would try to just assign the high level lineage manually, but the paper actually means that they also try to train the model to assign it using the XGBoost trainer, but I feel that it's quite troublesome, so I just skip it. But for you, you can also try to run the XGBoost training for this high level lineage, which is that use the AppCam and PTPRC to assign the cell type for each of the cluster, and then I will just try to split them into epithelial cell type only to try to train with the classifier that has been trained before, right? Okay, so this is the subset of the epithelial cell only, and then I can try to train it. And so this is how I predicted the cell type here based on the XGBoost classifier. And I have intact and the castrate there 28. We have also assigned them accordingly. Okay, so we can see how they actually look like. If let's say based on their assigned way, what is that name already? Yeah, would be something like this. So maybe because I didn't really train the high level lineage using that classifier, based on what I manually separate them after the NMF and graph based clustering method, it still have some residue of other lineage, which is the stroma and the immune cell. But you can see that there are very little of the blue and the purple here. Mainly are still the basal luminal 1-2-3 and the seminal vesicle. So which is like very close to their analysis also. So we can try to compare it yourself after you have run through the script. And this is how they do it in the way same for the immune cluster in other time point and also in the stroma time point. And so I think I have come to the end of trying to reproduce their data. So these two are the main differences and unique way that how this paper handling single star RNAseq dataset in a time series pattern, which is the first one is the NMF approach, which is the non-negative metric factorization to do the dimensional reduction. And then they use the XGBoost model, which is the machine learning model, to try to classify the cell type for the cells in the later time point based on the initial time point. I don't really know which method is more suitable for the single star RNAseq analysis. I think it really depends on our objective and the nature of the data set. So I also want to emphasize again the walkthrough and the exercise today with the paper is a very good way to try to aware that there are alternative methods to analyze single star RNAseq as compared to the standard and the commonly used direct way. I hope this video is helpful for you, and thanks for watching, and I will see you next time. Bye.